Hello friends and welcome back to Auto Decode. In this video, we'll be discussing about the functions of all the drivetrain components. The working and construction won't be discussed in this video. We'll be having individual videos for them. So I want all of you now to concentrate on the functions of the components, as understanding all these functions is very important before moving forward. In the next video, we'll be learning about drivetrain layouts, and I'll be introducing these drivetrain layouts at the end of this video. So stay tuned and let's go. Okay, so let's start with the functions of the drivetrain. The first function is obviously to transmit the power generated by the prime mover to the driven wheels. And while doing this, the drivetrain has to do this with maximum efficiency, that is minimum power losses. The second function is engagement and disengagement of the drive, that is engaging the power given by the prime mover with the driven wheels or disengaging it. Why does it have to do this? Because the driver needs to either speed up the vehicle, slow down the vehicle, or stop the vehicle and start the vehicle from stall condition. So while doing this, we need to engage and disengage the power given by the prime mover with the driven wheels so as to either engage a gear or stop the vehicle and again start the vehicle. Then the third function is the prime mover gives power output through a single shaft. A single shaft is rotating of the prime mover, but multiple times we need to split this power into either two wheels or four wheels, that is more number of wheels than one shaft. So for this purpose, we need to split the power, which is done by the drivetrain. There are various components that are responsible for doing this. We'll look at in the next slides. Then the next function is to vary the power given to individual wheels according to the terrain condition or the traction. In simple languages, the grip under the tire. So the drivetrain also does this function. It varies the power supplied to each individual wheel, either manually or electronically, depends on the type of the drivetrain. Then the fifth function is to select various combinations of torque and speed. So while driving, either we need to start from stall, in which condition we need maximum torque, or when we are cruising, we need to increase our speed. In that condition, we need the highest speed gear to work. So in different scenarios, we either need higher torque or higher speed. Depending on that, we need to engage different gears. This is also done by the drivetrain, and hence various set points of torque and speed can be achieved. And the last function is the reverse gear. Obviously, if the prime mover is a unidirectional prime mover, that is, it cannot rotate in opposite direction, we will need a gearing mechanism that will make this sense of rotation into opposite direction on the driven wheels. Otherwise, we won't be able to go in reverse direction. So in case of IC engine, the drivetrain itself has a reverse gear which allows the wheels to rotate in the reverse direction. But in prime movers such as electric motor, the motor itself rotates in opposite direction by just reversing the polarity of the motor. So in this case, it is not possible. So these are the six main components of drivetrain that we are going to discuss today. We'll be discussing detailed functions of all these components. So let's start with the first component, that is the clutch. The main function of clutch is engagement and disengagement of drive with the driven wheels. As I discussed in the first slide, we need to engage and disengage the power given by prime mover with the driven wheels in order to perform multiple tasks like slow down the vehicle while braking or change the gears in manual transmission, obviously, or while starting, give some initial thrust and then engage the gears. So this is where the clutch comes in picture. The clutch enables engagement and disengagement of prime mover shaft with the remaining drivetrain. And while doing this, the clutch has another function to follow, that is making the engagement and disengagement gradual and smooth. We are talking about friction clutch here. So the engagement and disengagement has to be gradual and smooth. Then the second point comes is reducing the noise and vibration while carrying out this engagement and disengagement. So as this clutch works on friction, the engagement and disengagement is gradual. As the normal force goes on increasing, the friction goes on increasing. As we know, F is equal to mu n. So as normal force goes on increasing, friction goes on increasing. So as this engagement and disengagement is gradual, the noise and vibration due to engagement and disengagement is eliminated by the clutch. In earlier cases, instead of clutch, sometimes dog clutches are used. Dog clutches are directly teeth getting engaged mechanically with each other. In this case, the vibration and noise was very high, which is eliminated in the friction clutch. So the third point is to prevent a torque spike on the whole powertrain. So consider a case when your vehicle is trapped in a pit or suddenly goes and crashes against a pit. In this condition, what happens is there is a certain high torque spike that is imposed on the powertrain of the vehicle. So if there is a friction clutch, then this friction is overcome in such case and the clutch slips instead of building up the torque on other powertrain components and hence protects other powertrain components from this torque spike. The fourth point is reducing jerk, obviously, as the engagement and disengagement is smooth and gradual, as I discussed just a few minutes earlier. So the passengers do not experience any jerk while engagement and disengagement of gears. So then last point is, no, sorry. The fifth point is to disconnect the prime mover while braking. Yeah. So while braking, what happens if the prime mover is engaged with the drivetrain and simultaneously we apply brakes on the wheels, then this braking torque will be built up on the drivetrain, on the prime mover. So if it is an IC engine and consider that this braking torque is built up on an IC engine, you might have experienced this while driving. If you release the clutch late, then the IC engine stalls. Why? Because there is excess torque that is built up on the IC engine. So the same scenario will happen in case of braking. If we brake and the clutch is not disengaged, then this torque will be built up on the prime mover, that is the IC engine, and it will stall. So we need to prevent this as this is not the desirable condition. So the clutch is used to disconnect the prime mover, that is the IC engine, while braking. Okay, so the last function is to disconnect the drive during gear change in manual transmissions we are particularly talking about. So why do we need to disconnect the drive during gear change? It is simple. If you know the gear changing mechanism, that is a synchro cone, synchro assembly mechanism, then you will understand this. Synchro assembly is a very delicate assembly. So if we engage or disengage the gears, that is change the gears during driving from the prime mover, then there is a high torque built up on the synchro cone assembly, which might damage these delicate components. Hence, we need to disengage the drive from the prime mover so that there is no torque buildup. The torque buildup is just due to the inertia of whole system and not due to the prime mover driving it, which is very less. So this is why we need to disconnect the gearbox while changing gears. So the next component is the gearbox. Here we'll be referring to strictly the manual gearboxes so that the concept shown is very easy and we understand the functions on an easy concept. Any type of gearbox it may be, but the functions are going to be the same. So we'll discuss the functions taking into consideration only manual gearboxes. Okay, so what is the first function? The main function, it is to achieve various combinations of torque and speed. So the gearbox has various different gear ratios. What are gear ratios? We'll be going through in a different video which will be explaining the theory of gearing. So various gear ratios are present in a transmission or a gearbox, which are used to achieve different set points of torque and speed. So as we discussed during clutch also, there is different demand of torques and speeds during different running conditions or scenarios of a vehicle. So if a vehicle is in stall condition and wants to start from the stall condition, you need high torque. And if the vehicle is cruising or running and you need to increase the speed, then you need more speed but less torque as the vehicle is already in inertia. So this is achieved by different gear ratios. Gear ratios is different set points or different ratios between the prime mover speed and torque and the driven wheel speed and torque. This is achieved by the gearbox. So in order to cover these various conditions, the gearbox gives various possible set points of torque and speed to achieve all the scenarios. The next point is smooth changing of gears. So there is a synchro cone assembly, as I already discussed. There is a synchro cone assembly. You can see it briefly over here. This is the synchro cone assembly. This synchro cone assembly is used to engage. Here also you can see it. See, this is the whole synchrocone assembly used to engage one of the two gears. So this synchrocone assembly enables very smooth selection and shifting of gears from one gear to another. So this is another function of the gearbox: reduce jerk, noise, vibration, and shift the gears smoothly. The third function is to change and control the direction of rotation of driven wheels if the prime mover is unidirectional. So this is obvious. If the prime mover is unidirectional, as we discussed in the first slide, there is a reverse gear in the manual transmission which enables the driven wheels to rotate in opposite direction in order to propel the vehicle in reverse direction. So this is the basic three functions of a gearbox. Here what you can see is all the manual transmissions. Other than these manual transmissions, there are various type of gearboxes which I have mentioned here. So now let us move on to the next component. The next component is the differential. The main function is to split the power between two wheels. As I already discussed, the prime mover gives only one output through a single output shaft that it has, but we need to split this power into two wheels while propelling the vehicle. So the differential does this function. It splits the power from a single shaft into two different shafts and delivers it to two different wheels. While doing this, the another main motto of differential is to achieve different speeds. Why? Just look at this illustration. While a vehicle is on turn, the outer wheel, consider here the vehicle is taking a right turn. So the outer wheel has a greater path to travel than the inner wheel. Thus, the outer wheel requires more speed to travel a greater path than the inner wheel, but in same time. If this is not done, if both the wheels rotate at same speed, then either of the wheels will slip, which is not a desirable condition. Hence, to achieve different speeds of two wheels, that is greater speed of the outer wheel and lesser speed of the inner wheel, the differential comes into picture. This is a small illustration of how it works. This is the differential gearing mechanism. There are bevel gears and spiral bevel gears. This is just for illustration right now. How it works, we'll be discussing it in the individual component video again. The third function, let's get back to it. It is to split power between two axles. Sometimes there is a scenario when not just two wheels, but all four wheels are driven. So at that time, a single power coming from the prime mover has to be split into two axles as well. So there, central differential comes into picture. The function is same as it splits power between two wheels, it splits between two axles. And the last function is to provide the final drive reduction. So basically all these automotive gearboxes are reduction gearboxes. What does that mean? Is they reduce the speed of the prime mover and increase the torque. Because the prime mover is not able to give a high torque equal to propel the vehicle. Thus we need to increase the torque. So these are the reduction gearboxes, and gaining reduction is the main focus of these gearboxes. So the final drive reduction is the reduction between, you can see there or even in this picture, this ring gear, yellow colored ring gear, and the green colored bevel gear. This green colored bevel gear comes from the output of the gearbox. So this is the final drive, that is the final reduction in a transmission or a gearbox. So this final reduction, which is very huge, as you can see, the bevel is very small and the ring is very large. So this large amount of reduction is very, very advantageous when it comes to reduction gearboxes. Hence, this is another function of a differential, to provide the final drive reduction. Okay, so now that we have discussed about differential, I'm coming back to the gearbox slide. There is one more thing to discuss. Is there any difference between these two gearboxes? Yes, these two are different varieties of gearboxes. This is a straight or inline transmission, as it is called, straight or inline transmission. And this is a transaxle. It is called as the transaxle. So what is the difference? There is only one difference. The straight or inline transmission doesn't have the differential incorporated in it, but the transaxle has the differential incorporated in it by default. There is no external differential. transaxle has incorporated differential in it. In case of straight or inline transmission, we need another rear axle in order to incorporate the differential. So let's move on to the rear axle now. Yeah, so the rear axle. If your engine is placed in the front of the vehicle and your driven wheels are the rear wheels, then you have the straight inline transmission attached to your engine or the prime mover, and then you have the rear axle having the differential mechanism in it. So rear axle is nothing else but the differential incorporated in a housing with two solid shafts driving the wheels. So what brings the power from the inline transmission to the rear driven axle? That is the propeller shaft. This propeller shaft connects the inline or straight transmission to the rear driven axle, which has the differential in it. So propeller shaft is basically two different joints connected by a tube. This is the tube connecting these two joints. What are these joints? These joints are called as universal joints or Hooke's joint. So first let us discuss the functions of propeller shaft. As I discussed now, the main function is to transmit power from gearbox output to the rear axle in case of a rear wheel drive. Rear wheel drive, this term, we'll look at it at the last slide. And the second point is to account for any change in the linear distance due to bumps or pits. This, what you can see, is called as a slip joint. Slip joint is basically splines. Splines is gear-like teeth but engaged into each other, male splines and female splines, which allow you to slide over each other but turn together. They turn together but allow you to slide over each other. So this linear joint allows you to incorporate for the change in the distance between the output of the gearbox and input of the rear axle when the vehicle goes through pits or bumps. This is pretty much all for the propeller shaft. Then let's move on to the next component, that is a transfer case. Transfer case will not be seen in all drivetrains because it is a particular component of a four-wheel drive layout. What is four-wheel drive layout? Again, we'll be discussing it during the last slide. So four-wheel drive basically means all four wheels are driven. The transfer case basically splits the power between the rear and the front axle, and it also gives the option to select whether you want only rear axle driving or you want the rear axle and the front axle driving. Along with this, it has another function of selecting two ranges. It has selection of two ranges. One is high and another is low. Let's move on to the next slide. The last component is the drive shaft or the half shafts. So when we took a look at the rear axle, there are two rigid shafts going to the two wheels from the axle. But in case of a transaxle, if there is a transaxle, then there are no rigid shafts. Transaxle basically allows you the freedom for both the wheels to travel independently of each other. How it is done? So this is a CV shaft or a drive shaft. It is also called as a CV shaft. CV stands for constant velocity. So these joints are called as CV joints or constant velocity joints. How do they function? Basically, these are two joints which can move or rotate both simultaneously. So the shaft transfers torque while simultaneously allowing the wheels to move in up and down direction. And it allows both the wheels, both side wheels, to move independently of each other, unlike the rear axle. Okay, so finally, we are here at the drivetrain layouts slide. So all the components that we discussed earlier constitute to a layout. There are various types of layouts which make the whole drivetrain. So as we now have learned about the components, we are ready to learn about all these layouts. So what are these layouts? Basically, these layouts are combination of all these components, all or certain components, in order to complete the drivetrain. So these are six main types of layouts which can be observed in an automobile. Every layout has different pros and cons and different applications. We'll discuss all these details in the next video. So please do watch the next video, as it is very important. Once you have understood all the functions of the components, you need to understand all these layouts in order to understand how a complete drivetrain functions. So please do watch the next videos discussing the drivetrain layouts. Thank you so much to watch this video, and please don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the bell icon. And yes, keep learning and keep teaching.